I start asking questions, what is Allah actually like, as opposed to he's just one, when we start to ask specific questions with regard to Allah, we get the same, Allah knows best. We do not ask how, but we want to know.
Because the Quran says Isa is the spirit as well.
Surah 4171 again.
Surah 4171, shall we read it?
Yes, please. Can you read this in Arabic, please?
I won't read in Arabic because most people here do not speak Arabic. We need to read it in English.
Because if you believe in a God that wants people to not understand his words, then you go and serve whatever God. The God we believe in wants us to understand what he says.
Say, how come Allah got the theology of Christians so wrong? It says to the Christians, the people of the book, it says this, sir, this is the mistake of Allah. This is the grave mistake of Allah. He says to us, say not three. Says cease. He says, for Allah is one. I want you to show me one verse in the Bible that says God is three. Normal human beings like you and I, he's met with them face to face, and he came for 33 years, and one day he will come back again and we will be with him forever. Now that's the message of the people of the book. That's the message of the people of the scriptures.
Not the message of the one who said, I am but a warner. I don't know what will be done with me. Jesus says, I am the way.
So Muhammad does not even know what will be done with him. But if you follow the Lord Jesus Christ, you know what will be done with you, which is a beautiful thing.
Amazing.
So we have shown today that the concept of the view of the Islamic God is contradictory in terms. It is a real mishmash. It is a real conundrum for Muslims. There's a real mixture. It's complicated and it's contradictory. We are seeing today that the Quran gets Christian theology wrong. If Allah is all-knowing, why did he not know what Christians believe, what the Bible taught? We have shown that Allah is described in human terms. This week to see what the Quran says about God. Quite an important investigation, I would say.
Yeah, because I think I always hear that Allah is one, he has no partners, he alone is the creator, but we have this issue with his spirit and his word. Beth, what's the issue?
Well, the all Muslims say that Allah is one. Isn't that the most important concept for Muslims? Yeah, you agree with us, sir. So what we find is that if Muslims say Allah is one, I decide to look at the Quran and see if the Quran supports this oneness of Allah. And the other thing I began to look at is not only is it the oneness, but something that our dear Muslim friends struggle, and I know my friends struggle to understand this, is when you describe God in human terms. My Muslim friends have a huge issue with this.
Yeah, especially describing God in human terms. When we start asking questions, what is Allah actually like, as opposed to he's just one, when we start to ask specific questions with regard to Allah, we get the same, Allah knows best. We do not ask how, but we want to know.
So, you believe Allah is one? Do you believe Allah is one?
Do you believe Allah is one?
We don't answer to you from our mind.
Okay, so
we answer to you from the Quran.
Very good answer. So, absolute? He says we don't answer you from our mind. We answer you from the Quran. And that's what we're going to look at today, sir. We're going to look at the Quran.
Okay.
So let's start looking at a few verses. We're going to start with a favorite verse that lots of Muslims point out to us. Surah 13, verse 16. Do you want to read it, Sarah?
Not a favorite one.
It's not favorite.
Read chapter 1.
Muslims like it.
Can you read?
Everyone has their own verse. But this verse is very particular in that it says, who is the Lord of heavens and earth, say Allah. Say, have you taken besides them Allah's not possessing even for themselves any benefit or any harm? Say, is the blind equivalent to the seeing, or is the darkness equivalent to the light? Or have they attributed to Allah partners who created like his creation so that the creation of each seems similar to them? Say, Allah, the creator of all things, he is one, the prevailing.
So in this verse, it's pointed out to the fact that there is some people who believe that there is something that God looks like its creation, and it's obviously disagreeing with that, that something divine cannot look like its creation. But what's more, it talks about how Allah is the creator, he is the only creator, and he is one. So this verse points to this oneness of Allah. We're going to ask if the Quran both supports that, and if there's a contradiction in the Quran, as we're going to see through what the Quran teaches about this Allah, about this God. Is it a consistent theology or is it contradictory?
So just to be clear, we should have nothing creating. Only Allah should be creating.
Sarah, does something create other than Allah according to the Quran?
Well, that's interesting because we're looking at the spirit.
Let's talk about the Bible.
Sarah, you wanted to talk about the Quran.
No, we're going to talk about the Quran today.
Sarah 15, 28 and 29. Oh, mention O Muhammad. When your Lord said to the angels, I will create a human being out of clay from altar black mud. So at the moment, it's Allah saying, I will create.
Allah says he creates. Does anybody else create?
Well, if we move down to ayah 29, and when I have a portion of the trophy to my creator's soul, or in Yusuf Ali it says spirit, in Pictal it says spirit, then it says you breathe into them my spirit. Do you fall down prostrating yourselves to them?
So who is creating them? This is Allah. Yeah. He is creating, and his spirit is creating.
So his spirit is creating with Allah.
Okay, so we have Allah and a spirit. Let's look at the ru in Islam. Let's look at this. Surah 50 verse 16.
But I just want to ask, as a Muslim, any Muslims here?
What are you looking for?
Does the spirit create? Is the spirit a creator? Is the spirit a creator? The root of Allah. Root Allah.
You believe Allah is one eternal absolute.
Answer a question.
Because not begotten, nothing like into him.
Surah 15, ayah 29 says,
nothing like into him. Do you know what is that?
Yeah,
so wherever you come to step,
to compare
it is Allah.
Doesn't qualify. He doesn't want to answer the question.
So, according to Surah 66, verse 1 to 2, Surah 66, 1 to 2, it says, Allah breathed the ruh into Mary. So the ruh is in Mary. Obviously, there's creation happening there, according to Islam. Now, Christians don't believe a creation happened in Mary. There was something that was given. But Muslims believe there's a creation. So we're just talking about the Quran here. So the spirit was breathed into Mary. Then we look at Surah 50:16, and then it talks about how God is closest to us, to our jugular vein. So we're talking about something spiritual of Allah being a part of human beings.
But something gets even worse. When the spirit is breathing into Mary, it says that the spirit is actually, in the exegetes, Gabriel. Gabriel is the spirit. So Gabriel is creating with Allah.
Whoa! So do you see that? There's a big conundrum and a big dispute among Muslim scholars because they say the ruh might be the spirit of God or it could be Gabriel. And if it's Gabriel, that means Gabriel's creating the child in Mary. Do you see there's a problem here?
Yes, I have.
Something other than Allah is creating. No. This is a problem, folks.
The problem only here is your misunderstanding of
you God. Tell us what is your understanding. Okay, you tell us your understanding.
Be and it is.
Right. Wow.
That's how we create.
So do you know more?
That's not what the Quran says.
This is the word. The God sent angel Gabriel to give good news to Mary. How he created Jesus is very simple. That's how he created to be and it is. That's it. The only misunderstanding is you are creating here in your mind.
Do you know more than Ibn Abbas? Do you know more than Ibn Abbas? been a bus. Do you know more than the Tasbih Jalalain?
Yeah.
Jalalain, Ibn Abbas both say, our spirit, namely Gabriel. If Ibn Abbas says, by our command, Gabriel breathed.
Oh,
so,
What did I say?
If you're a better scholar than Ibn Abbas,
you disagree with your own Muslim scholar, sir.
Jibreel came to Mary to give her the good news.
And what else
Jibreel is the Ruhul
Amin. Let me read. I can read it to you.
Let me read.
So, Surah 66, verse 12. And Maryam, the daughter of Imran, who guarded her chastity. And Allah says, and we, why is he using we? I don't know. And we breathe through our Ruh. We breathe through our spirit, it says, through our Ruh. And she testified to the truth of the words of her Lord. And Allah said, be, and he was. That is Isa. What happened before? What happened before, sir? He breathed his spirit, whether that's the spirit or Gabriel, into Mary. That's what the Quran says. So you have to take the whole verse, sir. You just took one bit. No, the whole verse says the Ruh is breathed into it. That's very interesting.
Surah 19, we find that Gabriel appears to Mary as a well-proportioned man.
Why you are not reading chapter 112, which is very clear about God?
We're talking about Allah.
You are telling about Allah according to Quran.
We started
chapter
with God
112.
Is one. We started that God is a creator.
Very clear.
But you don't want to get into the minutiae. So they acknowledge that God is God.
We started with that.
But when we start to ask specific questions about your Holy Spirit, then we get problems.
Okay, let's go to something else. If you're hung up on the Ruh, let's go to the Word of God. The Bible says that Jesus is the Word of God. And the Word of God became flesh and dwelt among us. John chapter 1. Let's look and see what the Quran says. The Quran says in Surah chapter 85, verse 22, it says this. Do you have it?
Yeah. But this is an honored Quran inscribed and preserved in a preserved slate.
So according to Bible.
So it's talking about the eternal Quran that is preserved on the slates, eternal slates or eternal tablets.
Yeah.
Folks, that means there is an eternal Word of God that coexists with Allah. Do you understand what that is saying? There is eternal Word of God that coexists with Allah in Surah 85, verse 1 and 2.
But how can there be something eternal? Because I thought eternality was something only ascribed to God.
And that's what Christians believe, certainly. But do Muslims believe that? Muslims say that God is eternal. But here we have a Word of God. It says it's eternal. Doesn't the Quran say that Isa is eternal?
It does.
Or it says he's the Word. It doesn't say eternal. He's the Word.
In Surah 4, Ayah 171, it says that not only that he's the Messiah, it says that he is a Word from him, Rahim Manu, and also says, sorry, Spirit from him, and also his Word.
So Isa is both a Word and a Spirit. That's quite intriguing. So we know that the Word of God is eternal. So that means there's something coexisting with Allah that's eternal. So even according to the Quran, if they logically put their verses together, rather than just randomly separating them, but put it all together, it says Isa is the Word. It says God's Word is eternal. Therefore, Isa is eternal.
It's very simple, though.
It is simple. That's the logical conclusion of Islam, folks. Because Islam tried to deny Jesus, but it couldn't get all of it out of there. Some of the truth remains. Jesus is the eternal Word.
Why is Jesus a Word from Allah? Why?
All the creation word from Allah.
Show us in the Quran where all of creation is a word of Allah. Show us. Show us.
Be and it was.
No. When Isa was born, we see that he is called a word from of Allah.
Yeah.
He's called a word and a spirit from
And we know that the word is eternal and God's word never changes. Therefore, Isa must be the eternal word.
So we have an issue with the spirit. The spirit of God could be a separate entity. It could be Gabriel, but it could also be Isa.
It could, because the Quran says Isa is the spirit as well.
Surah 4, 171.
Shall we read it?
Yes, please. Can you read it in Arabic, please?
I won't read in Arabic because most people here do not speak Arabic. We need to read it in English.
If you don't understand our language,
how do you want to understand what our book says?
It's interesting that Muhammad was sent to the Jews because they spoke Arabic.
The Jews spoke Arabic?
They're the Arabs because they spoke Arabic.
What are you saying? I don't get it.
So obviously Allah wants people to understand in their own language. Is that right? We're going to read Surah 4, 171, because if you believe in a God that wants people to not understand his words, then you go and serve whatever God. The God we believe in wants us to understand what he says.
So, I'm going to read Surah 4, 171, and it says this: O people of the scripture, that's supposed to be talking to you and I, and also the Jews, but specifically the Christians. O people of the scripture, it says this: do not exceed the limits of your religion, nor say of Allah aught but the truth. The Messiah Isa, son of Maryam, was a messenger of Allah and his word. So Isa is the Allah's word, which he bestowed on Mary, and a spirit. It says he is a spirit. So Isa is a spirit and a word according to the Quran. Now, actually, that disagrees with the past where it talks about, we know that Isa also came in flesh, but it seems that the Quran knows there's something special about Isa, doesn't quite know how to describe it, so calls him the word and the spirit.
But it gets it completely wrong.
It really does. It really does. Then it says that he's a spirit, but then it says this: created by him. So it's disputing what the Christians believe. We don't believe Jesus was created.
But we know in Surah 5:8-7 it tells us that it's speaking against the Christians, and it's saying that we have called Allah the Messiah. Do we call God Messiah?
Oh, we know the Messiah is from God and is someone that's coming from the heavens to us. Yes, we know that the Messiah is a divine being coming to us.
But the Godhead is not the Messiah.
Not in its entirety.
No, we know that Jesus come down, the Word come down, becoming flesh. So the Quran gets basic theology wrong.
Folks, we're going to point out another problem that of the Quran. See, remember, if Muslims believe Allah is one and Allah is all-knowing, as most of my Muslim friends here do say, how come Allah got the theology of Christians so wrong? How did he get the theology of Christians so wrong? Allah should have known what Christians believe. Let's go. It says in the same verse, Surah 4, 171, it says this. It says to the Christians, the people of the book, it says this: sir, this is the mistake of Allah. This is the grave mistake of Allah. He says to us, say not three. Says cease. He says, for Allah is one. I want you to show me one verse in the Bible that says God is three. I want you to show one verse in the Bible where it says God is three. There is not one verse that says God is three. God is one.
I never believe that.
Where? I want you to show me one verse in the Bible that says God is three.
You guys
did when Jesus said in the Bible. One verse in the Bible where it says God is three.
No, brother. So, answer the question.
Where does it say? No. He just quoted the Quran.
How many?
The Quran. You just quoted the Quran, Abu Wahid.
It's not his fault. The Quran has led him astray. astray, maybe using the Christians' belief what they really don't believe.
Absolutely.
He's been a faithful Muslim, but he's been led astray by the whoever wrote the Quran not understanding Christianity at all.
Rahid, you just quoted the Quran. That was a mistake in the Quran. The Quran does not teach that Mary is part of the Trinity, as you have just said. Nor does it teach that God is three. Never teaches that.
Show us in the Bible.
Where does it say that Mary is part of the Trinity? Where does it show in the Bible? Abu Wahid, where does it say that Mary is in the Trinity?
They have a Mary either.
This is the Word of God. This is the Word of God. I want you to look at what the Bible says. The Quran gets it wrong.
So it's very interesting, when he wanted to talk about Mary being part of the Trinity, he pointed to a statue.
If you don't know about Catholic, you are
like, even the Quran calls us people of the book.
Let's go to the book.
And when we go to the book, we do not find that.
And we find that if Allah is all-knowing and all for eternity, why did he not know that Mary has nothing to do with the Trinity? And why did Allah think that we believe in three gods? Why does Allah think we believe in three gods? Where did he get that idea from? Folks, I need to ask you a question. When Jesus said, the Father and I are, he didn't say the Father and I are two. He didn't say the Father and I are five. He said the Father and I are one. Very clearly, the Father and I are one. He never said two. Okay? He said one. And then when Jesus gives his last command, the Great Commission in Matthew 28, he says, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. The one name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. One name, Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
If Allah was truly God, truly omnipotent, truly had all knowledge, he would know the distinction.
Absolutely.
He would know that we completely affirm the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. But we completely affirm, not identifying, Father, Son, Holy Spirit as the one Yahweh.
And in the verse you just quoted, hear, O Israel,
yes,
the Lord your plurality. So it's one God, but the plurality in the oneness is one. So there's this complex plurality in the oneness.
But isn't it the same one that when it's talking about husband and wife and the two become one flesh? It's the same one it has.
Yeah, it's the same one.
So again, we see something. And doesn't that explain mankind? We are all one, but we are very diverse.
Absolutely.
We
reflect our Creator.
Amen.
We reflect our Creator. Folks, we're going to look at some of the very human descriptions of Allah in the Quran. One thing that Muslims struggle with are the very human descriptions of Allah. Because Muslims struggle to say, when we Christians say, according to Genesis 1:27, that we are made in His image, Muslims struggle with that. And so we're going to look at how actually the Quran talks about physical parts of Allah, but also that this Allah actually has come to earth, which is an anathema to Islam. And this is according to the Quran.
Oh, but should we go there?
We should go there, Sarah. We should go there. Surah 27 and 28. But before we get there, Sarah, let's look at some of these verses. So we have a lot of verses. It describes Allah with a countenance, with a face.
So Beth, Allah has a face in Surah 92:20.
Yes, and it says this, seek Allah's face. Remember that this God is a God that is incapable of entering our realm according to Islamic theology. He is a God who does not become a human being. He is a God that does not walk and talk with us. This is the God of Islam. We're going to look and see how actually according to the Quran goes against its own theology. It goes against the theology that most Muslims believe. Because very clearly we see the Quran telling Muslims to seek Allah's face. Now, if Allah is utterly other, untouchable, immanentable, high above us, and not near us, except remember the verse says he's near our jugular vein, that means this God we can't touch can actually actually come near us. Hang on a minute. How does that happen? How does this God we can't touch, that is far above us, actually come near us?
It's a real big problem. It's a real big problem. We explained it before, and it talks about through the Spirit. But then that means that the Spirit has omnipresence.
Interesting. So the Spirit of God can come near to us. So that means then there's something separate to this Allah. So the Spirit of God can come to us. As a Christian, I have no problem that there's a Spirit of God. But as a Christian, you do have a problem, because if you're a Muslim, then you're one entity. God, Allah is one entity. So then there's a problem there.
Yeah, I would really like Muslims to explain that. Is the Spirit of Allah part of Allah? Is he completely separate? Like we see in the Exodus.
Muslim men,
Gabriel being called the Spirit of Allah, or is it
66, 12, 50, 16?
But if he's completely immutable, completely distant, why on earth is he asking us to seek his face?
Yeah, if Allah is completely distant, how can we seek his face?
We cannot get near him.
That doesn't make sense.
Why would he tell us to do something that we can't actually
see? The Bible tells us to do that because God has always walked and talked with us. So of course we can seek his face. In fact, we will see his face one day. He will live with us, but not with the Quran.
No, God spoke personally with Adam and Eve. God came down, he spoke to Abraham, spoke to Hagar, came down, spoke to Jacob.
According to the Bible.
According to the Bible. Okay. And so we have no problem God coming down and being close to us. But this is a real issue.
It really is.
Excuse me.
Where was it?
How do you see Allah's face?
Excuse me.
How do you
in
see
50, 16, 66, 12.
56. How do you see Allah's face?
You said according to the Bible, we see God. Yeah. In the Old Testament, how people were seeing God?
Moses see God, so God.
How he see God? Can you please tell me?
The Bible says it. We're people of the book. So we don't go beyond what the Bible says. Moses says, I have seen the Lord. And Hagar says, I have seen the Lord, yet I live.
Your Bible says
Okay.
Let's explain.
So this gentleman has just said that our Bible says nobody has seen the Lord.
Yes.
Actually, that's not true at all.
It's not true at all. In the Old Testament.
If we see the Lord in his glory, yes, we die. But many people have seen the Lord.
Oh.
So let's go to the Quran when Moses saw the Lord.
Okay.
When Moses saw God's presence.
Okay.
When God tangibly spoke to Moses. It's in your Quran.
I'm not talking about speaking.
Okay?
I'm not watching.
No. So, this is God on earth. Let's go to Surah 27, verse 10. And in Surah 27, in chapter 7, 27, verse 10, it says that God's literal presence is on earth. In Surah chapter 27, verse 10. Do you want to read it, Sarah? Yes, it does, sir. It says that Allah speaks to Moses. And then in Surah 28, 30, it says, from the fire.
Within.
Allah
he
is in the fire.
No.
It says he's in the fire. He says it's
What's
in the fire.
He can speak to angels.
Okay. What's wrong with that?
Fire.
Because Allah is supposed to be one. Which means if he's one, then in his entirety he has to be there. Because he's indivisible.
And we see God's presence is always on earth. Does he mean God?
So Surah 27 verses 7 to 10.
Yes. That means God is on earth.
It means his knowledge.
But when he came to it,
sir, this is the answer to your question.
Okay, listen to it.
Okay, the Quran, yeah? So this is Surah 27, verses 7 to 10. I'm just going to read verse 8.
Yeah.
Talking about Musa, well, I'll start from verse 7. When Musa came to his household, verily, I have seen a fire, and I will bring you near from here, from there, some information, or I will bring you a burning brand that it may warn you. But when he came to it, to the fire, he was called. Blessed is whosoever who is in the fire.
We're going to explain in a minute. Let us finish. We're going to show how it's his presence.
And whoever is round about him. And glorified is Allah, the Lord of the Alamin, mankind, jinn, and all that exists. O Musa, verily, it is I.
Allah,
the Almighty, the All-Wise.
Yes.
Allah said, it is I.
And what did I say?
I.
No, we're going to answer your question.
I am telling you, Moses, listen to God's voice.
What he's saying
now,
is,
how in the Old Testament
that
people
is what
see
he's
God?
Saying. Is your voice separate from you?
How in the Old Testament
sir,
people see God?
Is your voice separate from you? you,
you
sir.
You just claim something.
Is your voice
in the Bible
from
people
you?
Can see God.
All the way through. All the way through. It's not how they just
the
did.
Testament, so, how see how people see God.
Exodus 3:14. Did you look it up?
He doesn't believe his Quran.
No, you obviously don't want to follow your Quran.
Yeah. It says it's his voice. Why don't you believe what Allah says?
It's the voice.
Okay.
Say that. Hold on.
Okay,
you,
so
you're
did,
adding words.
Okay, did,
hold on.
Did
you're adding,
say,
adding words to your Quran. It says it's his voice. It doesn't say it's just his voice. I would be very careful adding words to what you think is God's voice.
And you are adding your understanding.
It also says in the Quran, Moses sees a burning bush.
Yeah.
He walks towards it. And then in the Arabic, Moses sees the fire. He's going towards the fire.
Yes.
And he was called, he would listen to this, he was called from the right side of the valley. So Allah is calling from the right side of the valley in the blessed place. Allah is in a specific place. He is in a blessed place. And then from the tree, Allah speaks from the tree.
Thank you very much.
In the Arabic, it says fi min fi. And it says Allah is in that valley. And then he says this, O Musa, verily I am Allah, the Lord of the Alimun. So we know, and also we also know, because
you know,
the Quran also
you know
says,
that, okay.
Musa gets a bit afraid. And what does Musa do? Musa, Allah turns to Musa because he's afraid. And Musa, and Allah says this, Musa, the prophet or the messengers don't get scared in my presence.
According
so
to
God's presence. Surah 28.
This verse, are you saying Moses sees God?
Yes.
How?
Yes.
How? He sees
God.
I see fire clearly.
Okay.
He's saying that.
He's
clearly saying, I hear voice.
He hears, and Allah says, not Allah says,
you are
it
making
is
your
me.
Own
I am here.
He sees the fire.
No, no,
he
no,
didn't
let's
see
read
that
it.
I see fire.
He is in the blessed place.
This is your interpretation.
Place.
Now my question still stands. According to the Old Testament, you tell me, according to the Old Testament, how people see God.
Do you acknowledge when he says it's a lie? Do you acknowledge when he says it's a lie? So you acknowledge that Allah is saying it's his eye, and he's talking from the book.
Yeah, voice.
Okay. So are you saying that the voice of Allah is separate to the being of Allah?
I'm not saying that. I am saying Allah's knowledge and his...
No, no, we're not talking about knowledge. We're talking about his voice.
That is your whole point. You don't understand Allah. When you start understand Allah,
you said voice.
You will not make these kind of statements.
You said voice, you didn't say knowledge.
If Allah wants, he can speak from anywhere. If he wants.
I ask you.
Do you disagree?
So is Allah...
Do you agree or disagree?
Not according...
If Allah wants,
no,
he can speak
no,
from
no, sir, not according to the Islamic theology.
Did he have the power or not to speak from history?
I ask you a very simple question. Is the voice of Allah separate from Allah? That's the simple question.
Is the voice of Allah separate from Allah is the question.
He doesn't want to answer the question.
Because he can't. Because it's a philosophical conundrum.
It's a difficult question for you to answer.
Where do you get that? Where do you get this understanding? Wherever you see, you hear the voice of God, you will see God as well. Where did you hear this?
So, no sir, we're looking at what your Quran said in Surah 28 verse 30.
I have read.
Where it says Allah was in the valley. He was in the valley.
It's very clear that it was
it's in the valley. No, it is not. No, it is not.
Moses here.
No, it is not.
Moses clearly saying what he sees is in fire.
End of story.
Thank you very much. Now your understanding, if you don't accept Allah's nature, which you are discussing, you can never understand. Now my question is,
Ladies and gentlemen, this gentleman is trying to say that Allah can speak from anywhere, but he is ignoring what the Quran very clearly says in Surah 27 and Surah 28. It says very clearly that Allah, he appeared in the burning bush. He says minfi in Arabic, that means in. He is in the burning bush. And then when Moses is getting nervous, Allah turns to him and he says, the messengers, O Musa, do not get afraid in my presence. So Allah's presence is there. Something intangible form. We're not saying he's a human being. We are saying that something that is tangible of Allah is in the bush.
No problem.
This goes against Islamic theology. theology. It goes against her, everything that Muslims believe.
If there was anything tangible, why Moses only see fire? That's my question.
And I find it interesting.
If there was tangible,
this is not a problem. This is not a problem for Christians.
No, you are not answering.
It's not a problem for Christians.
If there was something tangible, Moses is prophet of God.
Let me acknowledge that Jesus didn't say it.
So, since you don't accept what we're saying, let's read the Quran, because you need to accept what the Quran says.
Can I read it?
Okay?
I have read that many times.
So, O Musa, fear not, verily the messengers, fear not in front of me. In front of me.
You yourself read
the question of whether Allah can come to earth.
The answer is in the reading. You clearly said,
Moses
see fire.
He didn't say that.
Absolutely.
But he can see from anywhere.
Yes, he can.
Can I read it in Arabic?
It says very clearly that the messengers don't get afraid in front of me. That's what it says in the Quran.
So he's not in present form.
So what's more?
That is
so I'm going to read something from the Bible just to make it very clear. As Christians, we have no problem with God walking and talking with us, God seeing us face to face. We have no problem with that because he did that with Musa. He did that with Moses. It says in Exodus 33 verse 11, very clearly, the Lord would speak to Moses face to face. The Lord Yahweh would speak to Moses face to face as one speaks to a friend.
Beth, is this Torah? Is this
possible? This is the Torah. And the Quran tells Christians, the people of the book, to go back to their book, which is what we've done. So it says here, the Lord Yahweh speaks face to face with Moses as God speaks with a friend. God has always been walking and talking with us. Yes, always. But with Islam, they say he never has.
It's a very sad thing because God wants to communicate with us. God wants to have his presence with us. And he wants to let us know that we can be close to him. We can actually move towards him. He will move towards us. In fact, he did it first.
Yeah.
And so this is why it's so important that Muslims understand God can come to earth exactly as we see throughout the Jewish scriptures and our New Testament.
Yes. So Islam wants to say God can't come to us. And yet we see in the Quran that he has. So it is a contradiction in the Quran. What's more, the Quran also says,
I'm talking about nature of God.
No one has ever seen God except God, the one and only, who has made him known. Read the verses beforehand.
Who is himself God and is closer
and has made him known. Amen.
Hallelujah.
How did Moses see God? According to this
and sir, did you read the verses before it? Because the verses before it says the word was God and the word became flesh and made his dwelling among us in verse 14. And then verse, no, it's talking about Jesus. And then no one has ever seen God. It's just talking about the Father. Except God, the one and only. And then God, the one and only Son, has made him known.
Not Moses.
In the exact chapter where Jesus is proclaimed God, the one who was prophesied.
Yeah. So he has taken a verse out of context, but even in the verse that he has chosen to say no one has ever seen God, but God the one and only who has made him known. And the verse before it says this one and only God, this eternal word, came and dwelt among us. This one and only dwelt among us. The Bible teaches a God that always walks and talks with us. The Quran does not, except it has this anomaly in chapter 27 and 28, where the Quran says that Allah's presence was on earth, where Allah spoke to Moses in the burning bush. It's a real anomaly. It's a conundrum for Muslims.
There's a problem. There's a problem.
Sarah, there's more. If you look at
was in the
when a Muslim does dua, I want you to ask this question, dear Muslim friends. The next time you do dua, you do your salat and then you do your dua. The next time you do your personal prayers to Allah, I want you to ask this question. If Allah is one entity who you cannot touch, who cannot enter our realm and does not enter our realm, if he is far above you, what is the point of prayer? Because prayer is communication. If you pray, you expect Allah to hear and respond. If Allah hears and responds, that means he's entering your realm.
Yeah.
Folks, if you're a Muslim, you cannot believe Allah can enter your realm, except if you take those two verses that we pointed out. But in all of Islamic theology together, if Allah is inimitable, you cannot expect Allah to talk to you.
So he's saying that Allah doesn't want us to be frightened of him, which is
you have to believe. It's a belief of Allah. It's not that we are afraid. I'm showing you, I'm Allah, so you have.
Everybody
going to believe.
Are you saying that's why he doesn't want to
earth? He is on the earth, he is everywhere.
Right.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
This is a very simple concept. Just as you are your father, when you play with your kids, you don't play with your full strength. You'll hurt your tiny kids. You will weaken yourself. You'll become less. You're still a man. You're still the man that you are, but you become less because you're playing with your little children. God, when he comes and speaks with us, he doesn't come in his full power. He comes. Jesus came and he took on flesh. He became weak so that he could
know him.
So that we can know him.
Absolutely.
It's a loving act.
You see that?
Did you all hear what Sarah just said? She just said that if we have children, we don't behave with them as adults. We get on our hands and knees, we may play Lego if you like Lego or whatever it is that the kids like to play. You come down to their level. You put limit yourself to their level because you love your child. That's what God has done for us. Yes. Allah has come to not Allah. Yahweh has come to our level.
So Yahweh is the one of 124,000 of a prophet.
No!
What about Adam?
Okay, ask
the first one. Why Adam is
being sent to Beth? Verse where it talks about his eyes. So wait patiently, O Muhammad, for the decision of your Lord, for verily you are under our eyes.
So read that again. So it says here, this is Allah's eyes. Talk about Allah's eyes.
Every single person.
Wait patiently, O Muhammad, for the decision of your Lord.
We believe all Jesus was holding the word to Allah to tell us.
And verily you are under our eyes.
So Allah has eyes according to the Quran. Allah can see. Hang on a minute. Isn't that a very human thing?
Yeah.
Isn't human beings see?
No, it doesn't have
it's
eyes.
It's a very human thing. It says it has eyes.
He can't see.
No, it says Muhammad is in his eyes.
He's
under Muhammad's eyes. Allah's eyes.
Where is it? How can he
Allah see has eyes. Can Allah hear? That's a very human thing to do. If he can hear, then he's doing something that we human beings can do. Folks, if Allah can hear, if Allah can see, why can't he talk to us? Why can't he walk with us? Why on earth can he not enter our realm? If Allah can see and hear, why do Muslims reject the fact that he can walk and talk with us? If he can do half of what we can do, why can't he do the rest of what we can do? And walk and talk with us.
All powerful God, he should be able to do
you want
these
answer
things.
For that? Circle.
So what is your response to
response.
That?
Response. Chapter 112, verse 4, clearly telling, nor is there to him any equivalent.
That's what I said. Actually, he doesn't have eyes. He said, "You are
under eyes.
You are the nature of human beings.
So are you telling us that Allah doesn't have eyes, and he's so weak that he actually needs a human being to be his eyes?
No.
Isn't that what you just said? So he's just said off the verse that where it translates in English that Allah has eyes, that Muhammad is in his eyes, but he's just come back with the Arabic and he says the Arabic says that Muhammad is his eyes. That means Allah is so weak that he has to use a human being. to be his eyes.
I forgive you.
I just don't know what that
means. I can't forgive you because you are not Arabic.
Sir, do you understand what you just said?
Arabic is difficult to understand.
You have just said that Allah, sir, you've just said that Allah relies on its human beings.
That's even Muslim people, they compare.
You have just said that Allah has to rely on its human beings in order to be able to do something.
Yes. In which way?
Allah, God of the heavens and the earth, does not need to rely on a human being to do something. He just said that Allah has to use a human being's eyes in order to see.
There is a different meaning.
That is not the God of the universe.
You have to. There is a difference in Arabic, not English, to understand Arabic. I'm Arabic. I can understand.
You just said Allah needs Muhammad's eyes.
You didn't say anything. You just say, "Oh, I didn't say anything."
You don't want to know the truth.
Eyes don't say God has eyes.
Did you just say that Allah has to use Muhammad's eyes to see?
Yeah.
Did you say Muhammad is Allah's eyes? Or is Muhammad Allah's eyes?
Yes.
Then Allah relies on mere human beings to do anything.
Every good person.
That means Allah is small and relies on human beings.
I forget.
Do you understand what is just, sir? Sir, please, you don't need to forgive me. You need to forgive your Quran.
This is totally wrong.
This is what this gentleman has said.
God can't
in the English translation, it says that Muhammad is under Allah's eyes. But he says in the Arabic, it says that Allah needs Muhammad to be his eyes. That means Allah relies on a mere human being. That makes Allah very, very small.
It's a shame. It's a shame, isn't it, Beth? Because the beauty of the church is that can be Jesus' hands and feet.
When God said, "You are my hand to be banished,"
he is one who is all powerful. He comes down and he can do anything.
God has a hand.
But they are completely on mankind, on his own creation.
Islamic view of Isa is that he can't be a god. The Bible, the Quran denies that he is God. And yet, because God walks and talks with us, it means that God can do all things and is all powerful because he can walk and talk with us. But it is not because Allah doesn't walk and talk with you.
Yes,
because Allah cannot walk and talk with you, and he will not when you die. The fact is, Allah then is reliant on human beings to do anything that he needs to do on this earth.
It's such a shame.
He's reliant on prophets and on messengers.
Can you please tell me when last time Jesus walked and talked with you?
Read the Torah, if they actually read what the prophets wrote, they wouldn't know that God can come down and God is all powerful. They wouldn't get caught up in this trap where God is stifled by his own otherness.
And the other thing, folks, the whole of the Bible points to what we're going to have at the end times. And the whole of the Bible points that we are going to be with God one day.
Really?
Sir, shaking your head at the back there. Do you believe you're going to be with God one day? He's shaking his head. He's saying no. Well, the whole of the Bible is that you can be with God one day. You can be with God. Let's just look at what the Quran says about the end times. Well, at least something on Judgment Day, on the last day.
According to Bible.
So, Surah 68 verse 42. Let's look at Surah 68 verse 42. We're going to look at what is going to happen at the very end of days. And the whole of the Bible points to the fact that one day, if you accept Jesus Christ as God and Savior who died for your sins, then, and you accept and you follow him, you will walk with him for eternity. You will live with God. You will be with God. And God will dwell with you. Revelation chapter 21. But if you are a Muslim, Muslim, you have to ask yourself this question.
I have
to. Will you live with God?
Okay.
Will you be with
God? Is it the same God you're talking about who doesn't know the last hour?
So,
who doesn't
the
even
God
know
who took on flesh you're talking
that,
about right there.
So his sin will be like
who doesn't know when the last hour would come, yeah?
When did he say that?
On the day of resurrection, they shall be called to prostrate themselves to Allah, but they, hypocrites who pray to show off or to gain good reputation, shall not be able to do
so. Okay, so folks, it's talking about how the believers on the last day in Surah chapter 68 verse 42, it says that the people, Muslims and believers, will see Allah's shin. Now we're not quite sure what that is. It's the front of his leg. We're not sure why it describes it in quite that way, but the believers in human terms will see Allah's shin. That's what it says in Surah 68. But that's it. You're not going to see much more of him after that. Folks, if you turn to Lord Jesus Christ and you follow the Bible, the people of the scriptures, you follow the word of God, the Bible, it says you're going to dwell with him. You're going to live with him. He is going to wipe the tears from your eyes. There's going to be no more pain. There's going to be no more crying. All death will go away.
Really?
All sin will go away.
Really?
For God will make everything new. Yes, really.
What about this?
Sir, you follow a counterfeit that all that gives to you as Muslims and human beings is just a shin. All you're going to get, sir, is a shin.
Miss Betty, the
I don't just want God's shin. I want to see God face to face.
Mass murderers would be in Jesus in the eternity.
And you know,
what's worse? If a mass murderer like Hitler would
God
accept Jesus,
he
would be eternity enjoying with Jesus.
Do you want to see Jesus? Do you want to see?
Well, according to your theory.
Do you want to see God?
Theory,
sir,
Hitler would be lying with Jesus
you,
Christ.
Would you like to see God face to face? Would you like to see God face to face?
Why not?
Because
so that's what I find really sad. The Quran tells them over and over again.
Like Jesus,
three times. If you are uncertain of anything, go to the people of the book. He tells us that in Surah 1094 and in some other sources in Surah 21,
the Quran
tells us to stand firm in our gospel and Surah 5. If Muslims listen to Allah's command and actually went and read the Torah, read the Injil, read the prophets, they could know that God wants to take their sins away. They could know the beautiful relationship that we can have in Christ, through Christ Jesus, if they'd only
they don't want to accept that God has always spoken to his people face to face. Exodus chapter 33, verse 11, the Lord would speak to Moses face to face as a friend speaks to a friend. That's how God has always been with us. Genesis 3, 8 to 9, God was walking and Adam and Eve heard the Lord God walking in the cool of the day and he calls out to them. He's always walked and talked with us. He's met women, he's met men, he's met prophets, he's met women who were neglected, not just prophets, but normal human beings like you and I. He's met with them face to face and he came for 33 years and one day he will come back again and we will be with him forever. Now that's the message of the people of the book. That's the message of the people of the scriptures.
Not the message of the one who said, I am but a warner. I don't know what will be done with me. Jesus says, I am the way.
So Muhammad does not even know what will be done with him. But if you follow the Lord Jesus Christ, you know what will be done with you, which is a beautiful thing.
Amazing.
So we have shown today that the concept of the view of the Islamic God is contradictory in terms. It is a real mishmash. It is a real conundrum for Muslims. There's a real mixture. It's complicated and it's contradictory. We are seeing today that the Quran gets Christian theology wrong. If Allah is all-knowing, why did he not know what Christians believe, what the Bible taught? We have shown that Allah is described in human terms. And yet Muslims don't know how to describe that. And what did we show when it talked to, when God came to Moses, Sarah? What did we talk about when God came to Moses?
Clearly his presence is in the bush. He actually came to earth. But because of the rest of the Quran, the rest of the Islamic faith, one of the poor Muslims here was forced to say, it can't happen. He was in such a conundrum because there's contradictory things there. But Moses shows, in the Quran, it shows that Allah was on earth. That's what we see.
So, we know, according to chapter 27 of the Quran and chapter 28, that Allah's presence was in the place, in the bush, Minfi, talking to Moses. So, Moses presence. Moses talked to him. It's the one anomaly in the Quran that goes against the rest of Quranic theology, which says one of the few that goes against one of the many conundrums, I should say. But on this particular point, it's those verses that go against the rest of Islamic theology that says Allah is one and indivisible and doesn't come to earth. But we are shown through the Quran in those two chapters that yes, Allah has, but it's against Christian Islamic theology. So what you need to do, you need to come back to the Bible to understand that. It is the Bible that shows that God always walks and talks with us. It is the Bible that helps us understand that God has always wanted to dwell with his people. And Revelation 21 verses, well, the whole of the chapter, the first beginning of the chapter, the sinners will not be with God, but
you will be with God one day
if you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as God and Savior who died for your sins, because this is God come to us. We have no issue with that, Sarah.
No issue at all. It makes complete sense, and we're so thankful for a God that does that, for a God that cares enough to come.
Amen. Come back to Jesus, everyone. He is the one that explains, the God that walks and talks with you. This is the view of God. This is the tangible part of God, the part of God we can see and be with. Yes, God in his glory we cannot see, but God chose to make himself known and walk and talk with us. He chose to.